truth.
Yeah.
Hope they make a difference. Morning, church.
Good morning.
Are you excited?
Yes.
All right, I like that. Yeah, today starts Thanksgiving week. And actually, I started it this past Thursday. I had my motorcycle group come in last night, or Thursday night. I smoked turkey, and we brought all sorts of other things, and it was great. I'm really starting to feel the Thanksgiving spirit. Is anybody else here?
Yeah.
Well, hopefully by the time we're done today, you all be raising your hands, because that's required. Anyway, let's have a word of prayer and begin worship. Oh, Lord God, we are truly so thankful for, despite some of the things that have been going on this year, you still are God. You're still alive. You're still in our lives. And that makes all the difference. Lord, help us truly this Sunday to reflect on our lives, particularly our experiences with you, and to take joy, because it seems like the whole world has lost joy. But fill us with your spirit. Fill us with joy. Lighten our load. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I've got a few announcements to share with you. And while we're doing that, I would appreciate it if you all would fill out those connection cards. And I've noticed there's been a few that have come up missing. The pew ate them. But seriously, we do need these, so that if we do have an outbreak in this church, God forbid, we do have a way to do COVID tracking. I'm learning all this new vocabulary these days, so please do fill those out. Okay, let's see, we've got a poem in there. Hog Sunday is this coming Sunday. It's always an exciting time. Hog Sunday, Hanging O' the Green. And that's when we're going to be celebrating Christmas time, officially starting up. It's the first Sunday of Advent. And we hope that both during the week and also on Saturday, that we will get this place beautiful, all decorated up. Shelley's already shared with me some ideas that she has, which I think are going to be stunning. And we're looking for volunteers all through the week and also on Saturday. So if you can help out and help to make this place truly cheerful, and it doesn't matter if we go down to the point where there's only 5 people here, it is going to be a celebration season. Amen? That's right. So anyway, we do need your help with that. We also need help with Advent candle readers, lighters. I don't know, Shelley, do we have anybody yet for to bring in the hanging of the greens? Okay, I'm going to need some volunteers. Youth are welcome. But you know, everybody from 8 to 108 are considered youth when you consider God's age. So we need three people to do a little bit of reading to bring down the palm, the pine branch, not the palm branch. We'll do that later. The pine branch, the chrismond, and the wreath. And we'll have a short reading with those. So if you can help out on that, we'd sure appreciate it. It'd be great. And then let's see, what do we got? Thinking of You cards are on the table in the parlor. Those have been a great hit. And so let's keep those up. And then we are continuing to be looking for packages of mashed potatoes and for pancake mix. And Norma, I don't know, how do you put mashed potatoes in with the pancakes and make it into something? Okay, Norma says it, then that's the law. Anyway, those are my announcements. Are there some that you would like to add? Not seeing any hands waving wildly in the air. It is time then for us to greet one another with Christ's love. You know, we come in as individuals and small family units, but when we come together in the church and share Christ's love with them, one another, we truly become the church. And so I'd invite you at this time to stand where you are, turn around, and greet your neighbors and your friends. Okay, and since you have done such a good job standing, why don't you stay standing as we turn to one of my favorite Thanksgiving hymns, We Gather Together. I'd invite you to join with me this call to worship. Your words will be up on the screen. The eyes of all look to You, O Lord, and You give them their food at the proper time.
You open Your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing.
For the gift of this day and the freedom to give, You praise.
We give thanks to You, O Lord.
For the warm love and warmth of family and friends, both those gathered here and those gathered elsewhere, and all those gathered to your eternal home.
We give you thanks, O Lord,
for the good gift of children and grandchildren to nurture in your love, for the blessing of hearth and home.
We give you thanks, O Lord,
for the food you so graciously provide us and for the joy of feasting and celebrating together.
We give you thanks, O Lord,
for the blessings you bestow upon us each and every day, for the myriad of ways you work quietly behind the scenes on our behalf.
We give you thanks, O Lord.
Join me, please. And finally, for those things for which we are most thankful, the sweet comfort of your gospel, the forgiveness of all our sins by the blood of our Lord Jesus, the promise of our resurrection to eternal life, for the community of love, the church, for your word and scripture that is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path, for the gifts of baptism and Holy Communion, and for each person who so faithfully gifts of their time, their talents, their gifts, and their tithes. We give you thanks, O Lord. Let us sing together. Come ye thankful people, come. At this time, we share with God and with pray that that person is okay. Anyway, we share with God and with one another our joys and our concerns. And as usual, I like to start with our joys first. I got a note from Judy Mitchell Ferris that her niece and her niece's husband, who have been fostering three kids who have come from a troubled home, they have successfully yesterday fully adopted those three beautiful children, and those children are now in a loving home, safe. So Judy, congratulations to you and all your family. What a glorious Thanksgiving you have given those kids. What other joys do we have this morning? Norma, you may do anything you would like. Can I have one of the microphones, please? Thank you.
Made stockings for one of my organizations that I volunteer with. We have extra stockings, and these are three different sizes that I have. These are extras that I have. I would love to share with my brothers and sisters here at church. So if you would like some for your children or your grandbabies, please let me know, and I will bring them to church and leave them in the office for you. My phone number is in the directory, or if Shelly doesn't mind, you call her and she will give you my phone number, and I'd be more than happy to give these to you. If you let me know before December the 3rd, because I would like to get rid of all that I have. Thank you so much, and God bless.
You know, Norma shared with me a little bit ago what she was going to say. And I got to tell you, in a year that has been fraught with so many difficulties, she brought thanksgiving. She prayed to God to be cured of her cancer, and yes, I understand you never cured, but it's gone. And she promised that she'd do whatever God told her to do. You got to be careful when you make that kind of a promise, because God will change your life. But I have watched in the time I have been here the joy with which Norma serves this church and does so many things here and in the community. I got to say, God changed her life direction quite a bit, but what joy he has brought her. So thank you so much, Norma. Norma is one of those people who is behind almost everything that goes on around here. What other joys would you like to share this morning? Dave, I think you had one. All right. Dave Green has just shared that his son Dick and his daughter-in-law Amy had a brand new little baby boy. Hallelujah for that. Any other joys? Is anybody just joyful just to still be here in church? Yeah. Boy, I tell you what, it's with a little bit of alarm that I read all sorts of accounts of churches and bigger communities closing down, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, we just did that for Easter, now they're going to do it for Christmas too. And I am praying, and I ask everybody here to be praying that we will stay safe enough here in this community so that we don't have to worry about that sort of thing. But I want to be open for Christmas. And that needs a big amen from everybody.
Amen.
That's right. Any other joys? Any concerns? Norma? Okay, Norma has just shared that her friend Ed at Lang Chevrolet has been diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer, and almost everybody in this community has been touched in some way by people at Lang Chevrolet's. Please do keep him in your prayers. Any other concerns? James? James has requested prayers for a 15-year-old girl named Nilo in Olathe who has been diagnosed with an autoimmune disease. And you know that's the kind of disease which seeks to destroy you from within. So prayers for her. Yes, Janet? Janet has just shared with us that Jackie Davis, she and Claude have been visiting with us frequently, sitting right down there about on the third pew, and she has had successful hip surgery and is recovering now with some discomfort, but foot, I'm sorry. It is so hard to hear through those silly things. Had foot surgery. Hey, either way, it's a hallelujah. But she's home and she's recovering, so keep her in your prayers for relief from discomfort and that she'll heal quickly. Are there others?
Yes,
yes, Becky. Microphone. Yes.
Matthew injured his ulnar nerve, like the nerve that goes around his elbow. And it's injured enough to where the only thing that's going to fix it is surgery. So I'm going to be talking to the scheduler tomorrow. So he's going to have surgery on that, and probably, hopefully around Christmas time. So he won't miss school. So that's going to be kind of a big thing, big deal.
Definitely. Is that the one that we call the funny bone, that if you hit it?
Yeah, that right in that area, yeah. So every time he kind of gently places his elbow down, it feels like he took a hammer to his funny bone. So he's got to be real careful.
I hope
and
he
he's
has surgery
on medical
soon.
Leave from work and everything. And luckily, he just sits, you know, does online high school anyway, but still, he's always in discomfort right now.
You'll have to coddle him a little bit.
Yeah, I'm planning to.
Anyway, are there any other prayer concerns? And I'm not repeating that one, which is why I had Becky use the microphone. But I repeat these so that the people online can actually hear what you're sharing. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank you for Thanksgiving. Thank you for this time that we have, that we can set aside the burdens of this world and instead look with thanksgiving, with hope, with anticipation for the Christmas season, and a time simply for honest self-reflection. Lord, I pray for this world, that you will pour out your peace upon it and upon us. That you will speak sense to the leaders of the world so that they too may be filled with your wisdom, with your spirit, and that they will be moved to be true public servants, being a blessing to those they govern. Create in each one of us powerful islands of peace that the people whom we reach out to will truly be blessed. Even in our discouragement for the things of this world, Lord, fill us with hope and joy that we might share those as well and be a bright spot in the midst of gloom. O Lord, we give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who, when things truly were dire, gave his life on the cross, showing how much he loved us, taking away our sins and then proving that resurrection to eternal life is possible, so that regardless of what they did to him or what happens to us, we will be blessed and we can enjoy an eternity with you, O Lord, our God. Lord, we pray against this COVID virus that you will help the doctors, the scientists, the researchers, the laboratories, all to really cement together the cure for this disease. We pray that we'll be able to take and deliver effective vaccine, not only to all the people in this country, but to any all over the world who need it as well. Lord, in the midst of so many who criticize this country, let us be a beacon of light, bringing health and restoration to all who need it. And bless us, Lord, as you have done so many, many times before. Bless us. Create in us a genuine, thankful spirit, that we might acknowledge you, our God, and say thank you, Lord. Thank you. We pray all this in Jesus' name, as we join together in the prayer that unites us all as Jesus' disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ.
And Gail, would you share God's word and scripture with us?
This morning we're reading from the Old Testament from Psalms 34, 1 through 10. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his holy people, for those who fear him lack nothing. The lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Now would you please rise, if you're able, for the New Testament reading from Thessalonians 5, 13 through 23. Live in peace with each other, and we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, the patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. This has been the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated, and I'd invite Becky to share God's word in song.
This blood.
Love the message in the old rugged cross. It's a message that takes tragedy and humiliation to incredible victory. And some of the disciples looked upon Jesus dead in the cross or dead in the tomb. All they could see was doom and gloom, and that their hopes had been dashed. But on that third day, he rose up again from the dead. He claimed his place as the Lord of life and brought joy and hope back to the world again. And so we turn in this Thanksgiving Sunday, we turn to reflect. And I've got good news, kind of. The year 2020 is nearly at an end. Is anybody glad about that? I can hear them cheering online even. But what a year this has been. Oh my gosh. In all of my very many years, I cannot remember a year that seemed more dreadful. On New Year's Eve last, as we were watching the ball drop on television or watching the fireworks go off in Australia and then trailing around the world, the whisper of news was that COVID had been discovered in Wuhan, China. We didn't think an awful lot of it at that point, but by February, the virus had been detected here in the United States. And by mid-March, all 50 states, Washington, D.C., New York City, and all four U.S. provinces had reported cases of COVID. To this date, approximately 12.2 human beings here in the United States have been diagnosed with the COVID, and approximately 256,000 people have been have passed away with COVID-related deaths. We have experienced shortages of toilet paper, disinfectants. Our chicken and our meat supplies seemed in terrible danger. Businesses were closed. Restaurants were closed, and so many are closed permanently. We lost the German restaurant here in town. We've got several of our other restaurants who are just barely turning their lights on, and this thing isn't over yet. people are scared to come from their homes. You look around in church this morning, and you know, we had two services before, each of which had more people typically than are here right now. And that's no reflection on the people who are at home worshiping with us. It's just for them too dangerous to come out from their home. We've learned new words such as Zoom, social distancing, PPE, and mask mandate. And to top all of that off, we have experienced a season of some of the worst violence I've ever seen in this country, where legitimate protests were preempted and co-opted and turned into violent, destructive riots, some of which are still going on. People killing each other, people killing law enforcement officers, burning down businesses, all to express some sentiment of anger. And we've just experienced perhaps about the ugliest, meanest election season I can possibly remember. And so here we are nearly at the end of the year, and we're asking ourselves questions like, well, what do we have to be thankful for? Does anybody just really feel down and discouraged the way this year has been? Anybody? Nobody? I know better than that. We're Methodists. We very rarely raise our hands in service lest we be thought we're Pentecostals. But anyway, we ask the question, what do we have to be thankful for? But I'm here to tell you, this has not been all a bad year. For one thing, with all of the slowdowns, with so many people staying at home or working from home, so many factories being shut down or at least scaled back, amazingly, air quality around the world has increased drastically. I was looking online and I saw pictures in different parts of this world where once you could barely see through all of the smog, and you could see now crystal clear skies. It's as if this world is taking a moment to reset itself. People are learning to cook again. Maybe not as many as us here, but one of the things that absolutely astonished me when I was at the stores looking for such things as toilet paper, thank heavens I didn't run out, but I noticed that other things, normal cooking things that I would normally buy, flour, sugar, rice, beans, cans of soup of all sorts. I was seeing such shortages out there, and I realized, how many people have been going out to restaurants on a regular basis rather than cooking at home? And number one, they're learning how good fresh cooked food tastes. Amen?
Amen.
Number two, they're learning how to relearning how to prepare healthier food. And, oh, my goodness. I mean, to me, that's a joy. People are learning these basic skills all over again. You know, you turn on Facebook or the Internet, and you see them flooded anymore with all sorts of recipes for stuff that, man, I've known how to cook this forever. But, you know, that's been a good thing. Families have come together a little bit tighter because that's all they've got for entertainment is each other. And family units can get together and they can learn how to enjoy each other rather than running off in a million different directions. People have learned different ways to work. This whole thing about telecommuting. Oh my goodness. My youngest daughter, who was married here in this church, ever since this thing has hit, she's gone back to the office maybe 3 or 4 times. She has got a desk set up fancier than Shelley's office. She's got 3 screens set up. She's got her own desk and everything, and the work she does there is just as effective as what it is at work, and she's saved untold gallons of gas not having to drive all the way across the city just to go to work. We just found out SpaceX, a non-government agency, has successfully launched a space a rocket ship with real-life people taking them up to the space station before we've been depending on Russia to take our astronauts up to the space station. We don't have to depend solely upon them anymore. That's a good thing. Drive-in theaters are making a comeback. In fact, I've heard that somebody has purchased the drive-in theater just south of town here, and I am full of hope that we'll be able to actually drive in there, and despite what the virus is doing, we'll be able to drive in, pop one of those weird-looking speakers into our window, and enjoy a real-live movie on a big screen. Distilleries, oh my goodness, talk about good things. Distilleries have been doing what they do best. When this thing was so new to us, and hand sanitizer like these here, you know, if I'd put this hand sanitizer out before, I'd have had to hire a team of guards to make sure that, don't you touch that, just to make sure that they stayed in place. But distilleries, what are they good at doing? Making alcohol. And they started making hand sanitizer, and at first some of it smelled like bourbon, which personally I really like. But I mean, people began kicking in and helping out. Various companies like Ford and GM and Tesla stepped up. When there was a ventilator shortage, they kicked in, and whether they were urged by the president or did so partly on their own, it didn't matter. They started pumping out complicated ventilators until the point came where there supposedly there's nobody who has needed a ventilator that has not had a ventilator, and we're shipping them overseas as well. One of my favorite stories, y'all probably have heard the commercial from Mike Lindell, the MyPillow guy. I mean, he's on every station all the time talking about his pillow, his sheets, his mattress, and all this stuff. And I thought, this was incredible. Early on in all of this, when PPE, remember that big word PPE, was in such short supply, he turned over 75% of a very massive production company to do nothing more than to sew and make masks to supply hospitals and medical people. You know, we're starting to see a trend of people coming together, people asking, what can I do to be helpful? What some wonderful testimonies. Young people. Oh my gosh, you know, the younger people that are so good, younger people like in Dave Green's robotics class and stuff like that. I don't know if they made any of the face shields or not, Dave. Yes, they did. But all over the country, these young people, what are they so good at is computer stuff. They've got these neat new 3D computers, printers, that can make face shields. And every news station was talking about this group or that group or another group making face shields to protect us. And, you know, that's our young people. Let's see, what else have we got? We've got so many other things. A new enzyme has been discovered, and they're working on it now, that has been found to digest a certain kind of plastic, like in our water bottles, into its basic components that can be used for something else, and we don't have to put up with near as much plastic pollution. It's not as obvious to us here in the middle of this country, but you go out onto the coast and see islands of plastics that have been thrown out and discarded, killing fish, killing whales. But hey, speaking of whales, did you know that as of this year, humpback whales are making a comeback? Back in the 80s, there were just hundreds of them. And that has increased to over 25,000 humpback whales today. That is impressive. And the sea turtle population that was once very nearly extinct in 1973, it has grown by 980%. And as if that's not enough for things that we have discovered or has happened during this year, Advent is coming. And I got to tell you what, we need this Christmas season more now than I think any other time in my entire life. You know, it may be dark and gloomy, but Christmas is coming. When things for the Israelites were so horrible under Roman oppression, where they were being killed off, where they were living in extreme poverty, when they were virtually slaves, where there was no hope because the Roman Empire was so huge, what happened? God brought Jesus. And that has made every difference, not only just to them, but to the entire world besides. Christmas is coming. And so we ask the question again, well, considering all that's gone on, what do we have to be thankful for? Everything. We're here. God is yet alive. Jesus Christ is still resurrected and will be for all of eternity. And even though things may seem difficult now, it doesn't matter, because when this mortal life is done, we have that hope of resurrection to eternal life, to be with Jesus Christ in all of eternity. And that, my friends, trumps everything in our difficult 100 years or less that we'll be here. Although I pray that each one of you will live way longer than that, because I know I am. So anyway, I thought that today, since we do have things to be thankful for, we would turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verses 8 through 29. And in there he writes, "Give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell of his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, the miracles and the judgments he has pronounced. O descendants of Israel, his servant." And I would add, O people of Paola, "He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the word he commanded for 1,000 generations. The covenant he made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac. He confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. To you I will give the land of Canaan as the portion you will inherit. When they were but few in number, few indeed, and strangers in it, they wandered from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another. He allowed no one to oppress them. For their sake he rebuked kings. Do not touch my anointed one. Do my prophets no harm. So sing to the Lord all the earth. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods." So I return back to the beginning of this. Give thanks to the Lord. Call on His name. Sing to Him. Sing praise to Him. And you know, right now, that's exactly what we need. Because praising God does so much to lift our spirits. We've got so much in the world that seems to want to occupy our face, our time, with all the bad news. But why not look at what is good? And as Jesus said, there is no one better than God. Look to the Lord. Praise Him. You know, when we begin to praise God, our spirits are lifted. We begin to refocus our lives, to recenter our lives on that which is truly good, that which is absolutely permanent and eternal, that which cannot be changed. And a transformation begins to take place in us. As we remember that there is hope, that there is goodness, that it doesn't matter how dark the night is, how dark the winter is, in God is light, a light that cannot be extinguished. They tried to do that when Jesus was on the cross, and with a flash of light, He was resurrected from the dead. And He promised that ain't going to happen again. I don't know if He used the word ain't or not. But the intent was right there. When we begin to praise God and to be thankful, we really begin to do some important reflection and to realize, even for this year, as difficult as it has been, for every one of us, there has been joy. The news that Judy shared, that those three beautiful children had been adopted into a loving family, rescuing them from abuse and from disaster. You know, that's an island of joy. And I've heard so many other stories that are just little islands of joy. And so this day, this week, as we're getting ready for Thanksgiving, we have everything to be thankful for, especially when we start off with the Lord. And then all the rest of those things comes back to us as well. Do not let the media and other stories of doom and gloom wash over you, for God has promised to stem the flood. You know, this is the same Jesus who stood up in a boat in the middle of the sea on a dark and stormy night, held up His hand, say, stop, and the winds quit blowing. The sea became calm, and they rowed across to the other side. Let us be thankful. Lord God, give us thankful hearts. Let us rise early in the morning to praise You. Let us praise You all day long. Let us give thanks at the end of each day that You have been with us all the way through. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And the cool thing is, we have an opportunity to respond to God, to thank God, to really thank God, to that which we have produced with our own hands, which was, after all, a gift from God to begin with. And we have a chance to participate in continuing Jesus' ministry of loving and healing and bringing hope to the world through our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. And so by now, so many of you know, we've got various ways of doing that. We aren't taking the collection like we normally would, but we've got collection plates at the back, one on the side. We've got a QR code for the younger people who are busy with their 3D printers. They know exactly what to do with one of those. And you can do various things with checks and through your bank. And so at this time, on God's behalf, I accept your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings. And I ask you to stand for the doxology. Oh God, you have been so good to us. Through the difficulties of this year and others besides, you have stayed beside us. You have never given up on us, even when so many of us have felt like we ought to just give up. And Lord, you bring us the promise of Christmas, of your Son, Jesus Christ, God in human form, amongst your people. So we give you thanks this day and ask you, Lord, please bless these gifts and those who gave them. Magnify these gifts to your purpose in this church and in all the world besides. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. And as you remain standing, I'd invite you to turn to our closing hymn, number 672, God Be With You, Till We Meet Again. A joy to worship together with you this morning. I'd love to invite you to come back next week for Hog Sunday and for the beginning of Advent as we celebrate the coming of Jesus Christ, God with us, into this world. And next week we're going to be talking about preparing the way of the Lord. That's what we do during Advent and Lent. We prepare for the Lord, and we'll be working out of Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 through 9. So those of you at home and here, if you'd like to read up and wonder, where am I going to go with this one? There's your chance. Now, go out into this world thankful for all of the things that God has done. And be blessed in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Not be all else to me, save that thou.